Preparing for the ultimate disaster. Hi everyone, Leo Notenboom here for askleo.com. This is a topic that honestly, it makes a lot of people uncomfortable, but it's so incredibly important these days to make sure we understand and talk about it. And that is simply this: what happens to your digital world should something happen to you? By that I mean, will your family or your friends be able to get at your important accounts, to recover your information, to grab your pictures, to do whatever it is you would want them to do, should you be unavailable? And I say unavailable, of course, we talk about this primarily as a death scenario, but honestly, this also happens if somebody becomes incapacitated for some period of time, or any other number of things that prevent them from being able to work with their technology. Now, I have had several really sad stories over the years from the wives of military killed overseas, wanting desperately to get access to their email account to get their last thoughts or comments or photos or whatever. I've heard from the children of the elderly who are trying to get access to a password-protected computer and are unable to do so, and as a result are having a significantly more difficult time accessing this gentleman's digital legacy. Sometimes I can help, but more often than not, I cannot. It's important to understand that this is very real. We have moved so much of our day-to-day operation, be it banking or photographs or communication or email or videos, to the digital world. And, of course, we're locking it down securely. We want to make sure that nobody can gain access to our information, at least not without our say-so. And that's where preparation is key. Now, the first thing you have to do is understand who is it you're going to trust. The long-term goal here will be able to set up something so that somebody else can access your information should you be unable to. You need to understand who that person is. Who do you trust? Now, the confusion, of course, is that trust can change over time. It's not unusual for a person to be a very close friend today, someone that you actually would trust with your digital legacy, only to find out 10 or 15 or 20 years from now that they're no longer part of the picture, or that they no longer have that same level of trust. The good news here is that digital techniques will allow you to make it very easy to transfer this kind of access without really a whole lot of work. Typically, a simple password change will do it. The question, of course, then is, what is it you trust them with? Now, there are a lot of different philosophies to this. On one hand, you don't necessarily want to have to give them every possible password to every account you have, because those change. You will change passwords, and that means you'll have to update them every time. You definitely don't want to use a single password everywhere. It's not a case. It's not the right thing to do to say, hey, here's my password for all of my accounts. That's wrong for so many different reasons. The ideal solution is to give this trusted individual, or individuals, we'll get to that, access to one and only one thing. And that is a password vault. By definition, if you're using a password vault, it's always up to date. All of your current passwords are there. When you change a password, the password vault itself is updated. So the trick is to give that individual access to your vault. But that seems really scary because, of course, you're giving them access to everything. What's interesting is that a number of password vaults actually have a feature built in for exactly this scenario. In Bitwarden, which is actually the one that I'm using myself, you can designate individuals to be trusted contacts. That does not mean that they get immediate access to your vault. What it means is that they can request access to your vault. You will then get an email allowing you to deny access. However, if you're not around for any reason and enough time passes, then they automatically get access to your vault. This way, somebody is there to gain access to your digital legacy should you not be able to. Password vaults are wonderful approaches to this. Now, another approach, and I've done this myself in the past, is to use explicit encryption if you're not using a password vault. For example, years ago, I used to use a TrueCrypt volume. Now I would use a VeraCrypt volume. But the idea is that all of my sensitive information was in this volume. In fact, it's the volume that I used day to day. Once again, by definition, everything in that volume was up to date. All I had to share with a trusted individual was the passphrase for that volume. That way, if something happened, if they needed access, all they really needed to do was locate the volume, enter the passphrase, and they would have access to everything they needed. Now, a lot of times people have a really hard time identifying an individual to shoulder this responsibility. It's a big deal. It really is. So one of the variations that I think is very important to at least consider is what I call the two-man variation. It could have more than two people, but the concept is very simple. You come up with a passphrase for your password vault. It's the passphrase you use every day to open your vault. You give half of that passphrase to one person and half of it to the other. Alone, they can't do anything because they don't know the full passphrase. But if there is an issue, once they both agree that it is time to access your vault, then they would be able to combine their two pieces of knowledge and gain access to your digital legacy. It's important that the passphrase in this case not be something where if you know the first part, you can guess the second part. It really does need to be random words or something that just doesn't make sense as a full phrase, but it is something that would allow you that additional layer of protection, making sure that it requires two or three or four people together to agree that it's time to go in. What this boils down to is what I call a little documentation and a lot of trust. Setting this up is fairly simple. Like I said, the Bitwarden emergency access approach is what I use. I have a trusted friend, actually a couple of trusted friends, who can request access to my vault should something ever happen. That is the trust part. The documentation part is just letting them know that this exists and, in my case, providing in that Bitwarden or other secure location, some documentation that says, okay, here are the bank accounts, here are these accounts, here are these accounts, this is what you need to do should I not be able to be around. As I said at the beginning, this is an uncomfortable topic for many, many people, but I see the results of not addressing it, not being prepared all too often. Regardless of what approach you decide to take, please consider carefully, what will happen should something happen to you? Please don't dismiss this as being unimportant or that people won't care about your stuff. Trust me when I say they will. And they will appreciate it if you have given them the consideration beforehand. For comments, for updates, for links related to this topic and more, visit askleo.com/19633. I'm Leo Notenboom, and this is AskLeo.com. Thanks for watching.